¿Qué tal amigos? ¿Cómo están? Acá vengo nuevamente y ahora les traigo el discurso de nuestro presidente Nayib Bukele en el foro de Doha de ese año 2019 que apenas acaba de finalizar, el cual se llevó a cabo allá en Qatar. Pero por la magia, las posibilidades de la tecnología, es posible que llegue hasta donde estamos nosotros, y acá se lo compartiré, no sin antes hacer una pequeña reflexión. Y es que viendo cómo cada uno de los líderes mundiales hacían su entrada al foro, notaba que los fotógrafos iban acercándose cuando ellos entraban a tomarles fotografías, pero cuando el presidente de El Salvador, nuestro presidente Nayib Bukele, hizo su entrada, pues fue un mayor número de fotógrafos los cuales se aglomeraron ahí tomando fotografías, y por un mayor lapso de tiempo comparado con el resto de los dirigentes, que inclusive parecía que algunas personas tuvieron que retirar a un par de fotógrafos ya que no querían despegarse de Nayib Bukele. Y es que al parecer el resto del mundo sabe y reconoce que están frente a un líder de sabiduría y capacidades especiales, digo especiales, ya que no son muchas las personas en el mundo que cuentan con esta capacidad. Y quiero que sepan que no estoy dándole el crédito a Nayib Bukele en sí, porque yo reconozco que la capacidad de cada ser humano no proviene de él mismo, sino que proviene de algo divino, proviene de lo alto. Y este es el caso de nuestro presidente Nayib Bukele, que en donde pone su pie, donde él se planta, siempre llama la atención, el reconocimiento de otros líderes mundiales. Y es que parece que tiene una personalidad magnética, que todo mundo quiere estar junto a él. Incluso la presentadora de este foro no se fue del lugar mientras no se tomó una foto con nuestro presidente. Y es que Nayib Bukele fue el encargado de cerrar este prestigioso foro internacional. Y quiero que me entiendan esto, no eligen a cualquier persona para hacer esto, no eligen a la persona más aburrida o a la persona menos capaz, sino todo lo contrario. Para cerrar este foro lo hacen con broche de oro y eligen a la persona más capaz, más brillante, más ilustre que esté en ese foro, y en este caso, en este año, fue el presidente Nayib Bukele el que tuvo ese privilegio, el que se le cedió ese privilegio, y no decepcionó en absoluto, ya que él subió, se plantó y le habló a todos los líderes internacionales que estaban en ese lugar y les hizo un llamado de atención. Fue una exhortación que les hizo, ya que él menciona en su discurso que hoy día tenemos todos los recursos para acabar con el hambre a nivel mundial. Tenemos todos los materiales para que cada persona cuente con un hogar y no tenga que andar en la calle sin un lugar donde vivir. Tenemos todo el medicamento necesario para tratar las enfermedades de las personas y no dejarlas morir únicamente porque no tienen dinero, porque no tienen recursos. Ya que hoy por primera vez en la historia el mundo cuenta con recursos vastos, con producción vasta y aparte de eso, con la tecnología necesaria como el internet, por ejemplo. Ahora podemos decir que el mundo está completamente globalizado y se puede acabar con las guerras, el odio y el hambre a nivel mundial. Y es por eso que el presidente Nayib Bukele hace hincapié en esto. Es hasta hoy que tenemos esa posibilidad, pero no se ha tomado otro paso más. Entonces, ¿qué es lo que estamos esperando? Bueno, acá lo dejaré yo con la participación de nuestro presidente Nayib Bukele. Espero que la disfruten, a pesar de que no he podido traducirla al español. Pero bueno, es nuestro presidente, es el símbolo de nuestro país y el que nos representa a nivel internacional. Y la verdad es que no decepciona. Así que acá está.
Prime Minister, Your Excellencies, Presidents, Heads of State and Government, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, of course, ladies and gentlemen, and dear friends. We now enter the very last session of the Doha Forum, which entails a bit of a generational shift. We just ended the previous session talking about one of the oldest institutions in the world, an institution that's turning 75. Well, our next guest is very far away from his 75th birthday. In fact, he is one of the world's youngest and newest heads of state. He took office just over 6 months ago when he won the presidential elections in June of this year in El Salvador. He is a political leader who understands and appreciates and knows the power of technology and social media. In fact, many of you will remember when he made his first speech at the United Nations General Assembly, he took out his cell phone and, yes, he marked the occasion with a selfie. So I do hope he'll have time for a selfie with me a little later. It is a pleasure to welcome to the stage President Nayib Bukele of El Salvador.
Thank you, everybody. Your Excellency Abdullah bin Nasser bin Khalifa Al Thani, Prime Minister of Qatar. Your Excellencies, Prime Ministers, members of cabinets of all the countries participating in this forum. My wife Gabriela and my daughter Laila, who's just turned 4 months today. Members of my cabinet and staff that came with me to Doha, members of the press and all the new media, the special guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends, everyone. Thank you for allowing me to give the closing remarks in this World Forum, where we have analyzed the urgent necessity to reimagine governance and multilateralism in an ever-changing world. But I wanted to raise the question that has been mentioned here numerous times with many interesting analysis, possible answers, and even conclusions. But all of our main questions regarding inequality, poverty, globalization, trade, governance, interconnectivity, youth, the fourth industrial revolution, jobs, wealth, the rule of law, climate change, even peace, have been analyzed without really looking deep into the unique moment of all human, that human civilization is living today. And this huge opportunity that we have right now, the uniqueness of this moment, is actually very short and very simple to explain. But don't expect an answer, because I and my team were only able to formulate the question. And this is the question. For the first time in human history, our civilization has achieved three benchmarks that were impossible to imagine a couple of decades ago. These three benchmarks allow us, for the first time in history, to fix all of the main problems of the world. Now, the first benchmark. Remember the 90s? Where globalization was the main topic in all of the forums, panels, everywhere? Well, I was in school and probably watching cartoons and playing video games. But the reality is that at the time we discussed globalization, if globalization was good or bad, if it was good for rich countries or for poor countries, we discussed if it was good for corporations or good for the people. The supporters of globalization tried always to convince us that it will be good for everyone. But aside if you like it or not, globalization came to stay. Soon we felt the pros and cons of globalization. It made the world a lot richer. International commerce and trade boomed and created lots of new opportunities. But at the same time, it also bankrupted hundreds of thousands of local companies. It destroyed entire economies. Hundreds of millions of farmers and their families emigrated to the cities in search for a living. Millions fell into poverty as local industries bankrupted and as major corporations moved their factories where labor was cheaper. But like I said before, you may like it, you may hate it, but 25 years later, the world is fully globalized now. And that's our first benchmark, a globalized world. Now the second benchmark. Remember back in the 90s again, where the internet really started to take traction? I mean, we all know that it was invented decades ago, but it really took traction in the 90s. As every important company had a web page and teenagers were downloading illegal music from Napster and messaging through ICQ or AOL instant messages. Thousands of new dot-com millionaires and even billionaires started to appear as the market was overvaluing web traffic and paying hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars for a web page. Then the bubble bursted and the economy tanked as the stock market took a gigantic hit from the dot-com bubble. But despite the economies of it, the internet was still growing very fast, in fact exponentially, and is now an integral part of our lives. We live now in an interconnected world. We spend more time in our phones than any other thing. I'm not taking a selfie, don't worry. Yet. In fact, they are not phones anymore. You have your life recorded here. You have all of your friends texting you while I'm saying this speech. You have all of your social networks here. Your apps, your health, your mail, your music, videos. You get your news from this thing. Some people watch the movies in it, play, even create content for the whole world to see. And every year it penetrates more and more. More apps are developed, the cameras are better, more people connect. So even though we're 2 or 3 years from total connectivity, we can say we're there. So that's our second benchmark, an interconnected world. Now the third benchmark. For the first time in all of human history, we produce more than what we are able to consume. And definitely more than what we need to consume. We have more than enough food to feed everyone. We have more than enough medicine to treat everyone. We have more than enough wealth and materials so can everyone can have a decent home, a nice school for all children, a good hospital for anyone with a disease. All necessary roads can be built. All necessary transportation systems can be built. We have enough wealth to stop climate change, to even undo some of the damage we have done to our planet. We have enough wealth and resources to stop all armed conflicts, to provide a decent living for everyone. But instead of that, millions of tons of fresh food are dumped every day while millions of humans are dying of hunger and malnutrition. Millions of tons of medicine are destroyed because their due dates are passed, while millions of people don't have access to healthcare or even vaccination. Inequalities on the rise and unnecessary conflicts are created. But with all the bad things happening, one thing is certain. Production and worldwide wealth is at all time high. And that's our third benchmark. World production is now enough for everyone. Humanity never dreamed of having these three ingredients, but now we have them. So we are now able to end poverty, to end hunger, to care for everyone's health, to provide a great education for everyone, to stop climate change, to stop all wars. We just need the political will of the leaders of the world. This couldn't have been done before. This couldn't have been said before. Because the world wasn't globalized. So if you needed a product from India and you were in Mexico, well, that was a tough one. Before, the world was interconnected. Just to give you an example, a health record from a person in Brazil could take days and a lot of resources to reach a doctor treating that same person in Germany. A software developer in El Salvador, in my country, could not collaborate with a developer in Japan, and both of them be able to create something new, putting pieces together from both sides of the world. Now they can. Before we produce enough of everything, we couldn't feed some without leaving others with no food. Nations and societies had to compete only to survive. But we have none of those problems anymore. We are now fully globalized, fully interconnected, and we produce more than what we need to consume. So there, no more excuses, no more benchmarks to be met, no more time to wait. So we are obliged, it is our responsibility to create the world every generation since the dawn of civilization has dreamed of. We have the three ingredients humanity never had before. Let's find the formula for this new era. So, what are we waiting for? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, President Bukele, for helping us end this forum on such an uplifting, positive note. I, too, brought my cell phone, just in case we could do that selfie. We could do it now. Okay, excuse us for just a second. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you so much, President Bukele. And so now, as we do end this session, it is a pleasure to thank you all for being here, for making it such a memorable event. Thank you, of course, to our host, Doha, and the state of Qatar. I also want to thank all the wonderful panelists and speakers we've had over the past 2 days. Thank you to the Doha Forum sponsors, the forum's diamond sponsor, the Qatar Investment Authority, the platinum sponsors, Qatar Petroleum, Qatar Airways, and Qatar National Bank, QNB, and of course the official telecoms partner, Ooredoo. We would of course like to thank as well all of the Doha Forum's institutional partners, the content partners, and the strategic partners, which are Chatham House, the European Council on Foreign Relations, International Crisis Group, and the Munich Security Conference. There are so many other people, of course, to thank for putting together such a wonderful event. So thank you all very much, even if there is no mention specifically for you, but you know yourselves. Thank you. On a personal note, I'd like to thank the organizers of the Doha Forum for bringing us all together and for inviting me to be part of this event. I hope you'd agree that we all leave more energized and more refreshed by what we've heard and seen over the last 2 days. And so, before we bid you farewell, here's a quick reflection on the last 2 days of this 2019 Doha Forum.